I hadn't expected to get into Cambridge when I got there. Gore, they're all very bright. Yeah. Quite keen to let you know it. but terribly clever. And I'm not that clever, and they've made a mistake, you know, admitting me. They're going to discover their mistake and they're going to send me home. Huh. We have a name for this these days. Is it known to you?
Imposter
syndrome. Yeah, we didn't have a name for it then. It wasn't recognised. There's a risk that a student feeling that will take themselves off home mm-hmm. very quickly. Mm-hmm. And it's one of the things we have to look out for in Oxford these days. But I'd had a bit of a fight, more than a bit, quite a fight to get to that place. So I wasn't going home. I was waiting to be sent home.
Right.
And until they sent me home, I was going to work my very hardest so that when they did send me home, I wouldn't have a guilty conscience. I'd know I'd done my best and I just wasn't bright enough.
Which we know is not true. So way to prove them wrong on that. And you've got this amazing compact object that's like spinning itself around and spewing stuff out. And this is a Hubble plus Chandra image.
Hubble plus Chandra.
Right. So this is real data that NASA has collected of a pulsar, which is amazing. So then in 1967, I think is when you found this. Mm-hmm. And then in 1974, the Nobel Prize was awarded mm-hmm. for this discovery.
Yep.
But it wasn't awarded to you.
No.
T. Okay, so it was awarded to your advisor. Mm-hmm. And I think at the time, and also subsequently, this caused quite the kerfluffle because you discovered the object, but you were not recognized in its discovery, which Science Magazine called, quote, one of the most significant scientific discoveries in the 20th century. And I think, you know, a lot of other folks felt like it was one of the most blatant snubs of women scientists at a moment when we were just sort of getting on.
Yes, and I think also grad students felt it was a snub of grad students.
Yeah.
So some of my contemporaries changed Nobel to No-Bell mm-hmm. Prize.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah, and that makes sense. And it's interesting, right? Like, this point, I've always wanted to talk to you about this. When they asked if I would interview you, I was like, let's do it right now. But I've always wondered about this because, I'm going to frame it in Ta-Nehisi Coates' language of mythology and fact from yesterday. He talked about how, you know, facts can only do so much when we've got a mythology built around. Mm-hmm. You mentioned imposter syndrome, which is incredibly important for the work that we're both really interested in doing. So the mythology is that women just are inherently not as interested in science. Mm-hmm. And so our job, our moral responsibility is to get them interested, attract them there.
Yeah.
The fact is that we actually have the same interest because the brain is the brain and we have interests just like anyone else. And often what we're facing is a current, a headwind mm-hmm. in the direction of where we're going. Mm-hmm. So you mentioned you had already had imposter syndrome when you were at Cambridge. Then you have this discovery. It's sort of, you're overlooked for your own discovery. How did you feel and when that came out? And then how did you persist, right? That's a huge blow to the psyche and, to use mm-hmm. the technical language, mm-hmm. to the physics identity.
Well, I'm quite a political animal. I recognized immediately that this was a very, very important award. Up till then, no astronomer of any ilk had received a Nobel Physics Prize. And there is no Nobel Astronomy Prize. So this was a breakthrough.
Mm-hmm.
Created an enormous precedent, and I recognized that instantly. I'm quite a political animal,
mm-hmm.
And reckoned that, you know, other astronomers were going to walk through that door.
Yeah.
And that's been true. Since then, probably about 20 astronomers mm-hmm. have had the Nobel Physics Prize, so that's really, really good.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a little bit tragic, and it came at what was quite a difficult time for me. I got married very soon after the PhD, and by that stage I had a child. And in Britain, I don't know if it's true here, but in Britain, married women were not expected to work, and mothers certainly didn't work. Mm. The children would be delinquent, it was proven.
Mm.
I have great fun now talking to schools, and I say, how many of your mothers work? So, how many of your mothers worked? And how many of you are delinquent? There's usually one on the back row, but I don't see it here.
No, it's good, right?
Enormous pressure on women in Britain to conform to the female feminine image, mm-hmm. Which I find extremely difficult.
Yeah.
It was hard enough being one of the few women in science without having that burden as mm-hmm. well. I reckon a major factor in the discovery of pulsars was that imposter syndrome. I was so sure I was going to get thrown out that I was being really, really thorough. And I noticed this 10 parts in a million anomaly. So I thought, right, certainly science in Britain is a bit white male. Maybe we need more people who might have imposter syndrome. Mm-hmm. And certainly diversity would improve the community a lot. Mm-hmm. So I phoned up the chief executive of the Institute of Physics and said, would you like $3 million to set up a fund to fund postgraduate students in physics who come from backgrounds where there aren't many postgraduate students in physics? And without hesitation, without putting the phone down, he said yes.
That's amazing. Thank you for doing that. It will open the door for many, many folks. Yeah.